I think it's time to continue, and I would like all of you to take your seats. My name is Alexai Grom. I'm a pediatric rheumatologist seeing patients here in Cincinnati, but I also do translational research in a lab. Last night, perhaps first time in 10 years, my wife and I went to see a movie. And the movie that we saw was billed as a romantic comedy. It turned out to be a great movie about a patient with Still's disease, and I think it depicts very well what it takes to get to the right diagnosis in these patients. It's shown nationally, and it is my hope that this movie will increase the awareness of Still's disease and, by extension, of systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis in the country among physicians. Now I would like to switch the topic and talk a little bit about macrophage activation syndrome. Sorry? The Big Sick, yes. The name of the movie is The Big Sick, exactly right. It's a great movie. I hope it will change the perception of this disease in the country. Now, back to macrophage activation syndrome. In 1986, Anne-Marie Prieur, a very respected French pediatric rheumatologist, described five patients who developed a very bizarre complication that eventually we started calling macrophage activation syndrome. So the first paper, the first description of this clinical phenomenon appeared in the literature in 1986. In 1994, when I was a fellow here in Cincinnati, we lost a patient who had systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis, and the disease was complicated by macrophage activation syndrome. And since that terrible day, my research has been focused on this particular complication. We're trying to understand what it is, why it occurs, how we can diagnose it early, and what could be done to prevent it from happening. And over the next 20 minutes, I will do my best trying to explain what it is about and how we approach it. In general, we define macrophage activation syndrome as a clinical phenomenon caused by excessive activation and multiplication of predominantly two types of immune cells. One type of these cells is called cytotoxic CD8 cells, and the other type is macrophages. And excessive activation of these cells leads to massive inflammation that certainly might be, often is, life-threatening. So let's start with macrophages. Let's discuss a little bit what normal macrophages do in our body. It's a type of white blood cells that engulfs and destroys microbes and other foreign substances in a process called phagocytosis. So in general, it is the first line of our defense against microbes. When we get infected with microbes, macrophages approach microbes, and here we are looking, oh. So in this example, we are looking at this large cell is a macrophage. These yellow cells are microbes. And you see that literally the macrophage engulfs them and kind of swallows them. It forms a little granule that is filled with microbes. And if you look at this area of the macrophage, you see lots of tiny little granules. They are filled with what we call proteolytic or digestive enzymes. They are very, very similar to what we have in our stomach. And these little granules fuse with that large granule that contains microbes. And eventually, these microbes get digested and destroyed. So that the first line of defense of our defense against microbial infection. What happens in macrophage activation syndrome? For various reasons, and I will try to explain those reasons in a minute, these macrophages get overly activated, and they start phagocytosing and destroying our own normal blood cells, such as red blood cells, neutrophils, or platelets. And the destruction of these blood cells leads to a sudden drop in their numbers, and that potentially might be life-threatening. So in this example, we are looking at a bone marrow biopsy from one of my patients with systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis that was complicated by macrophage activation syndrome. And if you look at these figures, in each figure in the center, you see these large cells. Those are macrophages. And if you look there, sort of inside there, what we call cytoplasm looks very, very foamy. And the reason for that, they have tons of those little granules that are filled with digestive enzymes. In panel A, you can see that these macrophages start actually swallowing normal blood cell precursors. So these are very, very immature erythrocytes. So they get phagocytosed. In panel B, we are looking at a neutrophil that is being swallowed by a macrophage. In panel C, you can see these normal blood elements, blood cells inside a macrophage. And panel D shows that eventually these cells get completely destroyed. So this phenomenon, and the term, the scientific term that we use to describe this phenomenon is hemophagocytosis. That's the perhaps the central, what we call pathognomonic feature or diagnostic feature of macrophage activation syndrome. Now, another important type of immune cells that are involved in macrophage activation syndrome are called cytotoxic T cells. They're also often described as CD8 positive cells or killer T cells. And it's these are T lymphocytes. It's another type of white blood cells. And these cells are capable of killing abnormal cells in our body. It could be cancer cells, tumor cells, or cells that are infected, particularly when they are infected with viruses. And these T cells have a very interesting machinery to do it. So these are just some examples of how this killing may occur. So if you look at the figures above, you see some of these killer cells or cytotoxic CD8 cells. They are round. And in green, what we see there, those are tiny little granules that contain a few very interesting proteins. And we will discuss those proteins in a moment. When these T cells recognize an abnormal cell, in this case, we are looking at a cell that is infected with viruses, so they approach those abnormal cells. And now you see all these tiny little granules move towards the area of the contact between the cytotoxic cell and the infected cell. These granules eventually release some proteins. Some of them, when they are released, they kind of form a tubule-like structure that gets inserted into the target cell and literally makes a hole in the target cell. And that's the reason this particular type of protein is called perforin, because it literally perforates the target cells. And then some additional enzymes get inside the target cell, and they sort of promote killing. So at the end, you see this target cell, which is again a cell infected with viruses in this example, it gets killed, and the viruses get killed as well. So that's this cell population is very important in our immune system because it helps fight certain infection, particularly those that are invading immune cells in what we call intracellular. They get inside the cells. Now, coming back to macrophage activation syndrome, we typically describe macrophage activation syndrome as a cytokine storm, and I would like to explain that a little bit better. All our immune cells communicate with each other by sending various chemical signals to each other, and we call those chemical signals cytokines. Many of those cytokines have the ability to activate the immune system, other immune cells even more, and cause more inflammation. Some other cytokines actually have the ability to reduce inflammation. We call them anti-inflammatory cytokines. In macrophage activation syndrome, remember there is this excessive activation and multiplication of macrophages and these cytotoxic T cells that produce too much cytokines that actually cause inflammation, that are pro-inflammatory. And that leads to creation of this, what we call cytokine storm. Why it happens, we still don't understand very well, but what we do know is that macrophage activation syndrome is strikingly similar to a genetic disease called hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, or HLH, and I believe many of you are very well familiar with this term. Hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis is a genetic disease in which these cytotoxic cells have decreased ability to kill cells infected with viruses. So that machinery that I showed you earlier, this delivery of these granules to the area of the contact with the abnormal cell is not functioning properly. So as a result, these patients don't have the ability to kill infected cells very efficiently. So what we think might be happening here is shown on this figure. So here I'm showing you some cells that are infected with viruses. These cytotoxic CD8 cells, positive cells, approach them. They are supposed to kill them, but again, their diminished ability to do so leads to prolonged survival of those cells infected with viruses. These CD8 cells are trying very, very hard to kill infected cells, but they are not doing it very well. To compensate for that, they start multiplying, so we have more and more of those cells, and they get more and more activated, you know, trying really very, very hard still to kill those viral infected cells. Unfortunately, in the meantime, they produce lots of those chemical signals, those cytokines, that have the ability to stimulate macrophages. So poor killing leads to prolonged survival on infected cells, so they live longer. They are not eliminated properly, promptly. It also leads to this abnormal activation and multiplication of these cytotoxic CD8 cells, producing cytokines, and among those cytokines, I would say interferon gamma and GM-CSF are the most important one. And this continuous stimulation of macrophages with those two chemical signals, it leads to their expansion, uncontrolled multiplication, and in turn, these macrophages start producing more chemical signals to activate other parts of the immune system, including the same cytotoxic CD8 cells. So at some point, we start seeing this, what we call vicious circle. This two cell populations producing those chemical signals that have the ability to stimulate each other. And in the meantime, that chronic stimulation of macrophages with interferon gamma, that what makes those macrophages get completely mad and they start phagocytosing, destroying our own blood marrow elements. So that's what we think is happening in hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis. We certainly see, if you look at our patients with macrophage activation syndrome, we see very, very similar things. If you look, for example, at the biopsy of the inflammatory lesions in those patients, we would see lots of those cytotoxic CD8 cells and lots of macrophages producing very similar cytokines. Probably many of you have gone through some genetic testing. Certainly, we now know that about one-third of patients with macrophage activation syndrome have mild genetic defects that are similar to what we might see in hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis. And for that reason, although this genetic testing is expensive, but when we see a difficult case of macrophage activation syndrome, or when we see a patient with recurrent episodes of macrophage activation syndrome, we worry that there may be this genetic component. And somebody earlier mentioned the possibility of a bone marrow transplantation as a treatment. It is a definitive treatment in patients with hemophagocytic syndromes, genetic hemophagocytic syndromes, and when we pick up similar genetic abnormalities in our patients, we do consider this as a treatment as well. And in fact, we have a few patients who did undergo bone marrow transplantation with this similar, with this type of picture. There are quite a few genetic defects that we see in patients with HLH, but they all have something to do with the delivery of these granules to the surface, to the area of the contact with the infected cells. And I'm sure you're familiar with the names of some of those genes, including MUNC13, SYNTAXIN11, perforin, REP27A. So all these molecules are here. They are involved in this particular process. And I'm sure that many of you have been tested for genetic defects in these genes. Now let's move on and discuss a little bit the clinical presentation, that clinical picture that we see in macrophage activation syndrome. Typically, these patients become very, very sick. They look very ill. They run high fevers. But typically, the early features of macrophage activation syndrome are found in the laboratory evaluation. So remember, the central feature of the syndrome is those overly activated macrophages that phagocytose and destroy normal blood elements. So one of the first laboratory changes in these patients is a sudden drop in the numbers of red blood cells, in the level of hemoglobin, obviously, in the numbers of platelets and neutrophils. All of you are familiar with the test for ferritin. Ferritin is an inflammatory marker. It goes up in any inflammatory process, even if it's a mild infection. But usually it doubles, maybe triples. But what's interesting about systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis, the levels go up much, much higher. And when we look at the patients with macrophage activation syndrome, they are strikingly high. So certainly rising serum levels of ferritin, particularly if they are combined, if these levels are combined with decreasing platelet count, that's something that would make us think about the possibility of macrophage activation syndrome. Another place where in our body where these macrophages and cytotoxic T cells like to go is the liver. So they settle down in the liver, they produce those pro-inflammatory cytokines in the liver, and we certainly see significant liver abnormalities in many of those patients. Probably the first change would be increasing levels of liver enzymes, particularly AST and ALT. But remember, liver is a very important part of our body. Obviously, it does lots of things. And one of the functions of the liver, it makes lots of very important proteins, including those that are involved in forming blood clots. So as a result of that cytokine storm in the liver starts producing less proteins, including those that are involved in the formation of blood clots. So increased bleeding from mucosal linings, from the guts, increased bruising, very, very bizarre rashes in the skin that looks like sort of very extensive bruises. It's another very typical feature of macrophage activation syndrome. So overall, if you think about macrophage activation syndrome, it has been reported in association with almost any rheumatic disease, but certainly by far, it's most common in systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Some years ago, one of our fellows actually reviewed the literature, and we realized that approximately 80-85% of the reported cases of MAS in the literature, in fact, occurred in association with systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis. If you look conversely at all the patients with systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis, I would say approximately 10-15% of them might develop full-blown macrophage activation syndrome sort of in its life-threatening form at some point during the course of their disease. It usually happens when the disease is active, but unfortunately we started seeing more and more patients developing MAS even when their disease is controlled well with new biologics such as canakinumab or tocilizumab. And a typical scenario, these patients are doing well, then suddenly they get infection, and the infection triggers MAS. That certainly needs to be recognized very early, and again, treated aggressively because it may progress and become life-threatening. The other thing that I would like to mention is that although we believe that only about 10-15% of patients develop what we call full-blown macrophage activation syndrome, mild or subclinical MAS actually may be occurring in as many as one-third of patients with active systemic disease. And us, as pediatric rheumatologists, as physicians, we need to recognize this phenomenon very early, because if we recognize it early, just a slight increase in the dose of steroids may actually prevent the development of a full-blown MAS that would require a much more aggressive and much more toxic treatment. So again, when we suspect, when we worry about the possibility of MAS, particularly when we suspect subclinical MAS, the typical laboratory tests that should be sufficient for monitoring includes cell blood counts. Again, remember, we are looking for decreasing cell blood counts. We certainly see increasing ferritin in these patients, increasing liver enzymes. And one of the proteins that liver makes that is important for blood coagulation is called fibrinogen. Fibrinogen actually goes usually up in systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis. It's part of that inflammatory response. But when we develop macrophage activation syndrome, the liver is not functioning very properly. It produces less and less fibrinogen, which actually may put patients at risk for bleeding. So fibrinogen, that's another laboratory test that we find very helpful when we evaluate these patients. We are certainly looking for additional biomarkers of this phenomenon that would help us diagnose it as early as possible. Dr. Schulert in a minute will discuss some of those studies. But the two tests that we started using more and more are soluble IL-2 receptor alpha chains and soluble CD163 molecules. So again, coming back to this depiction of what might be happening in macrophage activation syndrome. Remember at the very beginning, I told you that in MAS, we actually are seeing the expansion of these two types of immune cells, cytotoxic CD8 cells and macrophages. These cytotoxic CD8 cells, when they get overly activated, they start shedding off some of the molecules that are present on their surface. And one of those molecules is soluble IL-2 receptor. Macrophages, on the other hand, have another interesting molecule, and we can discuss what it does, but it's called CD163. It's a very important molecule that actually is involved. When red blood cells are destroyed, they release lots of iron. Iron is actually very dangerous when it's present in its free form because it can cause what we call oxidative tissue damage. So when we see free iron in our blood, it needs to be removed very, very quickly. Actually, ferritin, the molecule that we talked about a few minutes ago, that's a molecule that actually binds to that free ferritin and kind of sequesters it and makes it less dangerous. And perhaps that's the reason we have so much, so high levels of ferritin, because we need to neutralize that much iron in our body. And the CD163 molecule actually is involved in that process. So what we know in at the later stages of macrophage activation syndrome, when we have too many of those macrophages, they are too activated, they start shedding off this particular receptor as well. And we can pick up this particular molecule in the peripheral circulation. So we think that using these two markers, we actually can monitor the behavior of these cells in macrophage activation syndrome. We can use it for diagnosis, for the diagnosis of MAS, but also, more importantly, when we are trying to assess the response to treatment, we actually can use those two markers as a very accurate measure of the response. Now, let's briefly discuss the treatment that we use in macrophage activation syndrome. Again, coming back to this cartoon, remember the central feature of this phenomenon, this uncontrolled expansion of cytotoxic CD8 cells. They produce too much of those chemical signals that have the ability to stimulate macrophages. So to calm down these cells, the first thing we could do is steroids. Steroids have a general ability to calm down the immune system in general. Pretty much all the immune cells will calm down in response to steroids. But often it's not sufficient. And the next step would be a drug called cyclosporin A. And this particular drug has the ability to calm down specifically this population of cytotoxic CD8 cells. So cyclosporin targets these T cell population, and it's actually very good at doing that. So that's typically the next step if we are not happy with the initial response to steroids. So high dose corticosteroids, cyclosporin, and then if we don't see a good response, then the next step is difficult. Certainly many of us believe that in some patients, So again, coming back to this picture, so remember, we are dealing with a cytokine storm, right? We have a vicious circle. We have these T cells producing interferon gamma and GM-CSF. They stimulate macrophages. Macrophages, in response, produce other cytokines like IL-1, IL-6, IL-18, and those cells further stimulate cytotoxic CD8 cells. So it's certainly, knowing that, it's an attractive idea to perhaps target some of these cytokines to calm down, to disrupt this vicious circle. Certainly, targeting IL-1 is one of the approaches that many of us have tried, and certainly there is a proportion of patients, not all of them, but there is a group of patients who would respond to high doses of anakinra. So I'm sure many of you who had MAS had been treated with anakinra for this reason. Another treatment that potentially could be used in more difficult patients is something called etoposide. It's a very toxic drug that actually comes from the field of oncology. It is used to treat hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, and it's a very potent drug. It has the ability to kill all the immune cells very quickly. So it's potent, but sometimes we have to use it, but it certainly comes with a price. And occasionally if we kill all of the immune cells, we may compromise the immune system to the extent that it cannot handle infections anymore. So we occasionally have to use etoposide, but again, we try to avoid it as much as possible for the reasons I just described. So the alternative approaches that are being tried right now in various clinical trials are targeting some other cytokines. The most promising approach is a new monoclonal antibody that targets interferon gamma. The phase 3 clinical trial of anti-interferon gamma antibodies had been completed. The results look good. The FDA requested a full phase 3 trial, and in fact, the drug already had received a breakthrough approval for the treatment of difficult familial hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis. And we really hope that perhaps next year we will start a clinical trial of this monoclonal antibodies in patients with macrophage activation syndrome. We just finished the protocol. The protocol had been submitted to the FDA, and we are waiting for the sort of final initial response. So targeting interferon gamma certainly is a promising approach. The problem with this approach is that I think long-term use of interferon gamma may be dangerous. It may predispose us to various infections, particularly tuberculosis. So this is going to be a short-term treatment, only when we have a very difficult case of MAS, just sort of get over that acute phase. I don't think we will be able to use this drug prophylactically with a purpose to prevent future episodes of macrophage activation syndrome. Another interesting approach that looks promising is IL-18. Grant, are you going to talk about IL-18? So I will skip that, this is something that certainly is being actively discussed. And another approach, are you going to talk about JAK-STAT inhibitors in general or not? So another interesting, potentially interesting approach is the use of JAK-STAT inhibitors. So I'm sure you've heard about some of these medications. There are quite a few of them. And what they do when those cytokines, those chemical signals that stimulate immune cells, when they bind to those cells and stimulate them, they activate what we call lots of different signaling pathways. And most of them, in fact, are JAK-STAT signaling pathways. Blocking that particular pathway may help to deal with this cytokine storm. Because remember, it's a cytokine storm. The cytokines stimulate immune cells. They activate all those signaling pathways in those cells. So I'm not sure whether JAK-STAT inhibitors will be good as a treatment for acute episodes of MAS. But my feeling that may be good as a sort of baseline therapy to prevent future episodes. So they may be potentially used prophylactically. Again, there are lots of research studies that are happening right now, and so hopefully we will see some of the results published within the next couple of years. And I think that was my last slide. So thank you for your attention. Any?
Can you tell us a little bit about the outcomes of the bone marrow transplants? Are the patients in full remission, or are they still needing biologics and just making the disease a little more manageable?
Right, so we, when it comes to patients with systemic JIA and macrophage activation syndrome, our experience is relatively limited. You're probably familiar with the paper that was published by the group from Holland. Brinkman was the first author on that paper. That paper was published about 10, 15 years ago. And in fact, in those patients, the bone marrow transplantation was used not necessarily for MAS, but for patients with difficult to treat systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis. And certainly there were some successful examples, but you probably know that there were two patients who actually developed macrophage activation syndrome recovering from the bone marrow transplantation procedure. So that story discouraged us in many ways, and that's a reason for many years after that publication we were very cautious about even considering bone marrow transplantation in our patients. But things have changed dramatically since that paper, and what has changed is the what they call conditioning regimens for bone marrow transplantation. So we think that those episodes of MAS that occurred in that study were related to the way those patients were conditioned for the procedure. The conditioning regimens for at least for HLH have changed dramatically, and if you look at the outcome of this procedure in again in familial hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, it keeps improving. So now with this data from the HLH literature, now we sort of now again revisiting this idea of perhaps performing bone marrow transplantation in some of our patients, particularly in those who do have some genetic defects that we just discussed, and those who have recurrent episodes of macrophage activation syndrome. So our experience here is limited to only two patients. They actually were, one was from here, Michael Hendrickson. I don't see him today, right? Dan, you might know the long-term outcome in that particular girl. At least as of the beginning of the year 2017, I think it was probably a couple of years after the initial procedure, she was still doing very well. Another patient that Grant and I were involved peripherally came to see us, they came from Chicago, and she actually did have genetic abnormalities. She was a heterozygous for a mutation associated with familial hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, and I think that was the last straw that sort of tipped us towards the decision to proceed with the bone marrow transplantation. It was done about 4 or 5 years ago. Recently, we approached the family because we wanted to get an additional sample from her for research, and she was doing well. So, two examples. But unfortunately, I heard from my colleagues from Holland that at least I'm aware of one death. So again, at this stage, we really need to follow very, very closely what happens in the HLH field. They're getting so much better at matching bone marrow. They're getting so much better at improving the conditioning regimen. So I think we are approaching that point where I think this procedure should be considered for many of our patients.
Our daughter has been on anakinra for 8 years and successfully managing the disease as best we can tell. One of the things that we struggle with is if we wean her off, that we've heard anecdotally more than anything else, the risk of the drug not being effective if she tries to come back on. So this whole idea of can she manage without anakinra after 8 years, and can we get her off of that? There's a risk of it not being effective coming back on. Can you speak to that at all? Are you aware
of
that?
Well, it's not an easy question. So there are a couple of things. The first thing is we certainly do see what we describe usually in the medical term as tachyphylaxis, should I say it? Initially we see a sort of very, very good clinical response to a medication, and then suddenly we see that response disappearing. We see it particularly often in patients treated with anakinra. I think some of it may be related because, remember, it blocks receptors. The receptors are expressed on the only type of cell that does not express receptors, actually, is red blood cells. So the anakinra neutralizes those receptors, but those receptors are generated back very, very quickly. So anakinra is removed from the body, but the receptors keep coming back. So it looks like some patients do this better than the others. And I think those patients are losing the response to anakinra very quickly. So that's one issue, right? And then in those patients, we typically try to switch to medications like canakinumab and perhaps tocilizumab in some of those patients. There are patients who actually keep responding to anakinra very well, and we don't see that diminishing response over time. So the question here is, let's say if we try to stop the treatment and the disease comes back, will it be more difficult to recapture the control of the disease after stopping the treatment? I'm talking about, you know, the number of patients that I'm thinking about right now, you can count with my fingers. So far, in all of my patients, we could recapture the response relatively easily. My colleagues, what is your experience? In patients who did show a good response to anakinra and you stopped the treatment and the disease came back, how difficult was it to recapture the control of the disease with anakinra specifically in systemic JIA?
I agree with you specifically with anakinra, but I think
you talked about antibody formation. But do we have any evidence? Yes, right. So what Dan is referring to is all these biologics are proteins, right? So there is also always a potential for the immune system to recognize those molecules as foreign and develop neutralizing antibodies. We know that the risk for this to happen goes up if we interrupt the treatment, we stop the treatment, then sort of introduce the drug again. So when the immune system is exposed to the drug continuously, it looks like it's sort of, well, it's probably something that belongs to my body. But if it's exposed to this intermittently, then it might start thinking that, well, probably something that does not belong to my body, and I need to react. So certainly with various medications, particularly anti-TNF drug, the drug called Remicade, we see that if we interrupt the treatment, the risk for the development of those antibodies goes up. I don't think we have much evidence to suggest that similar things are happening with anakinra. Anakinra, it's the good thing about anakinra, it's an almost exact copy of a naturally, Jennifer just discussed that with you, it's an almost exact copy of a naturally occurring molecule. There is only one amino acid substitution. So really, it's very, very, very similar to what we have in the body. So I think the risk for that is not particularly high with anakinra, but again, certainly that's something that we always consider. So coming back to your question, 8 years of anakinra. The question is, can we stop or should we continue, right? I think Luke, having done quite a bit of biomarker research in this patient population, I can tell you that in some patients, the disease is completely controlled. And if we look at various features of the immune system, it looks like the immune system is back to normal. In some patients, we still see sort of subclinical activation of the immune system. The patients look fantastic, and we think it's because of better control between better balance between those pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory cytokines. But still, there is sort of background activation of that immune system. So those patients are more likely to flare when you stop anakinra. And now we have some evidence that a couple of inflammatory markers, including S100 proteins and perhaps IL-18, another the cytokine IL-18, We think that sort of measuring those in your situation actually might be helpful to make a decision. So what I would do in your case, I would look at those proteins, and then if they are normal, I would try to skip a few doses and see what happens. In my experience, if the disease comes back and we quickly go back to the treatment, typically we can recapture the disease relatively quickly. The other thing I would like to mention is actually Novartis right now is developing a large biomarker program. There have been several very large clinical trials of canakinumab. Most of those patients after the clinical trials now have been followed very closely for additional, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 years, right? And all those patients sort of kept, we kept collecting biologic samples from those patients. And in fact, one of the goals of this biomarker program is to in fact identify additional biomarkers that would help us make these kind of decisions. So I think the big meeting is what, in October, right? So we will see, hopefully the program will produce additional biomarkers.